Welcome back to the Imaginary Gallery. It's TJ, your host. We're in the Psychopath Bag of Tricks, and the very last video from this book, the second part of the last chapter, Without Conscience, The Disturbing World of the Psychopaths Among Us, by Robert D Hare PhD, Damage Control. Dr. Hare begins by telling us that unfortunately, even the most careful precautions are no guarantee that you'll be safe from the predation of a determined psychopath. In some cases, the matter may be beyond your control, as it usually is in an arm's length financial relationship with a psychopath. Many frauds and scams are perpetrated against brokerage firms, banks, houses, savings and loan institutions, pension funds, and so on. Individual investors have no say in day-to-day operations, and they can lose money through no fault of their own. As an example, a distraught high school counselor recently had told Dr. Hare about an investment broker who lost several million dollars from the teachers' pension funds the broker had been entrusted to manage. The counselor was out several hundred dollars, and not because he was careless, but because the officials responsible for finding a reputable investment banker had been conned by a slick psychopath. And we've got a gray box. Forensic psychologist J. Reed Malloy tells of his being snared while interviewing an applicant for a job whose entire resume eventually turned out to be a fraud. The interview went quite smoothly, though, Malloy said in a telephone interview. He said he was very impressed with this guy. Couldn't get over how bright this guy was. As they talked, he'd drop in a phrase here, a phrase there, that really had this man standing back and thinking, wow, this guy's brilliant! How do I get him to want this job? It took him a while, longer than he'd like to admit, to figure out that he was quoting from several papers that the interviewer had written and had recently been published. He was impressing the interviewer, yes. But with what? With his own brilliance. Ideas of this interviewer he had thought a lot of. A normal person might say,
I read your paper and I thought this and I thought that.
But this fellow, who turned out to be a complete imposter, had an intuitive grasp on what among all possible things would get him to do what he wanted. For him, the interview was a great opportunity to perpetuate a scam. Perhaps the most heart-wrenching situations are those in which frantic, bewildered parents try to deal with a psychopathic son or daughter. Almost as distressing are those in which someone doggedly searches for a means of coping with a psychopathic spouse. In these types of cases, as well as those in which the psychopath has managed to enter your romantic life, about all you can do is attempt to exert some sort of damage control. This is not an easy task for most people, but Dr. Hare's got some suggestions for you. His first suggestion is to obtain professional advice. He says that he gets a lot of calls from concerned people who think that their child, their husband, their wife, or friend is a psychopath, and they want his advice on what to do about it. He says he cannot offer advice under these conditions. A proper diagnosis of psychopathy by a knowledgeable clinician is time-consuming and requires a good deal of reliable information, including an intensive interview with the individual in question, and across to collateral and corroborative information, and access to collateral and corroborative information from a variety of sources, family members, employers, friends, business associates, police, and so on. Make sure the clinician you consult is familiar with the literature on psychopathy, which is a good one. Some may not be aware of this, or they just lump it in some other category and just focus on the wrong things and say, well, it's you, you did it, and no, you didn't. Make sure it has experience dealing with these psychopaths, preferably in the context of family therapy and intervention. He also suggests if you have the resources, you should get several different opinions. If you go to one therapist and they don't have a clue what you're talking about, just say, let's focus on you only. Let's not focus on what you're going through. Get over it. You may want to go to a different therapist. It can be very frustrating. Dr. Hare says that he cannot count the number of times a telephone caller, usually a wife or a parent at their wit's end, has described repeated attempts to get someone or anyone to understand the problem, or even to recognize that there is, in fact, a problem. A typical telephone call he received was from a lady in Maine who had read a newspaper article about Dr. Hare's work and was convinced that her husband perfectly matched the profile of psychopathy outlined in the article. From what she told him about this guy, it appeared that she might very well have been right. For more than 10 years, she'd been trying to get professional help, starting with her family doctor and moving on through a succession of psychologists and psychiatrists. to no avail for all. The problem was that her husband always put on such a good show that her account of things was seldom believed. None of these clinicians could see beyond the husband's charming and convincing display. The poor lady did begin to believe that she was in fact the problem. Even after a solid diagnosis has been made, your troubles are far from over. The next steps will depend on your particular situation and should be planned with the aid of a competent professional experienced in dealing with these types of creatures. State psychiatric and psychological associations usually have a list of clinicians that they can recommend. You might also try local mental health and university counseling centers. Don't blame yourself. Whatever the reasons for your involvement with this creature, it's important that you not accept blame for his or her attitudes and behavior. Psychopaths play by the same rules, which are their rules, with everyone. Of course, your own personality and behavior will have something to do with the specific nature of the interactions that occur. For example, a woman who stands up for her rights may be physically abused, whereas a more submissive woman may spend her life wondering about the whereabouts of her philandering husband. A third woman might walk out at the first sign of trouble and never look back. In each case, the basic problem is having a psychopathic husband in the first place. Get rid of it! Similarly, parents of a psychopathic son or daughter continually agonize over their own role in the development of the disorder. It's very difficult to convince these parents that the chances are they didn't do anything wrong. Again, they may have ameliorated or exacerbated the situation, but there is no evidence that parental behavior causes psychopathy. Be aware of who the victim is. Psychopaths often give the impression that it is they who are suffering, and that it is the victim who's to blame. Common practice, I have seen. But they are suffering a lot less than you are, and for different reasons. Don't waste your sympathy on them. Their problems are not in the same league as yours. Theirs stem primarily from not getting what they want, whereas yours result from a physical, emotional, or financial pounding. Recognize that you are not alone. Most psychopaths have lots of victims. It is certain that these creatures who's causing you grief is also causing grief to a lot of others. Tracking them down to exchange stories and information could help you deal with the problem, if only to demonstrate that it is not you who's at fault. Everyone is vulnerable to this creature, and there is no shame in being victimized. This may be difficult to accept if you have just been conned and are too embarrassed to complain to the police or to testify in a courtroom, but you may be surprised by the number of other people in your community who have also been taken in by such creatures. Be careful about power struggles. Keep in mind that psychopaths have a strong need for psychological and physical control over other people. They must be in charge, and they will use charm, intimidation, and violence to assure their authority. In a power struggle with one of these creatures, it'll usually always focus on winning. This doesn't mean that you shouldn't stand up for your rights, only that it's going to be very difficult to do so without risking serious emotional or physical trauma. In some cases, you might be able to use the psychopath's win-at-all-cost philosophy to your advantage. For example, in a local case, a lady and her psychopathic ex-husband were engaged in a prolonged and bitter custody dispute over their two kids. The lawyer for the lady, realizing the man was dangerous, was intent on winning and didn't actually care about the welfare of the children, advised his client to agree to a joint custody agreement. And this is what the ex-husband had wanted all along. And having won the battle, he lost all interest in the children. Although the lawyer's tactics worked in this case, he ran a great risk of having the man decide to exercise his right to joint custody, with potentially disastrous consequences for those poor children. Set firm ground rules. Although power struggles with the creatures are risky at best, you may be able to set up some clear ground rules, both for you and for the creature, to make your life easier and begin difficult transition from victim to a person looking out for yourself. For example, this may mean that you will no longer bail it out of trouble, no matter what the circumstances. A lady that he knows was caught up in a web of financial manipulation and deceit woven by a glib consultant. Every time she confronted him, he convinced her that he was working on the problem and that she would soon get back the money he supposedly had invested for her. Finally, in desperation, she decided not to discuss anything with him unless there was a third party present or everything was placed in writing. It soon became clear to her that she was getting nowhere with this creature, and she began legal proceedings to recover her money. Reasonable but firm ground rules. What you have to do to live here may be the only way to preserve your sanity when dealing with the psychopathic son or daughter. These rules must be clear and consistently enforced if they are to stand any chance of having any kind of impact. Specific parenting skills and strategies are outside the scope of this little booklet, but the books listed in the notes for Chapter 12 can provide helpful information. Don't expect dramatic changes. To a large extent, the personalities of these creatures are carved in stone. There's very little likelihood that anything you do will produce any fundamental sustained changes in how these creatures see themselves and see others. They may promise to change and even show short-term improvements in their behavior, but in most cases you'll face years of disappointment if you believe that permanent changes for the better have occurred. Even though some of these creatures do mellow with age and as a consequence become somewhat easier to live with, in most cases they remain what they have always been. The problem is particularly tragic when it is a son or a daughter who's psychopathic. In a frantic search for help and understanding, the parents typically find themselves shunted from one professional or agency to another, seldom with satisfactory results. These bewildered parents use an enormous amount of energy and resources in generally unsuccessful attempts to understand and control their child, and in most cases they face years of frustration and demands to bail out their son or daughter out of trouble. Cut your losses. The psychopath may succeed in shattering your self-confidence and may convince you and your friends that you're unworthy of his or her time, or even that you are losing it. The more you give in, the more you will be taken advantage of by these creatures and their insatiable appetite for power and control. Rather than make fruitless attempts to adapt to a hopeless situation, usually by giving in, accepting your lot in life, or losing your self-identity, it may be better to recognize that your emotional and physical survival requires that you take charge of your life. This can be a tricky move, even dangerous, and requires good professional advice, both clinical and legal. Of course, if you're a parent of a young psychopath, you cannot simply give up your child to the Queen Elizabeth. You will have to work closely with teachers, counselors, and clinicians experienced in dealing with psychopathic children, no matter how modest the expected results. Use support groups. By the time your suspicions have led you to seek a diagnosis, you already know that you're in for a very long and bumpy ride. Make sure you have all the emotional support you can find. Many organizations and groups are devoted to helping these victims of crime to understand and cope with their plight. In most cases, the victim learns that he or she is not alone and is able to share their experiences with other victims. For example, most urban areas have crisis centers and support groups concerned with domestic violence, emotionally and behaviorally disturbed children, and victims' rights. Depending on the nature of the problem, one or more of these established groups may be of real benefit to you. But what we really need are support groups specifically designed for victims of psychopaths. Perhaps this book will help encourage the development of such groups.
I am the most gorgeous narcopath of your wildest dreams.
I'm here to give you a few more confessions.
I know we carried on for quite a while after your discovery, my cheating with the neighbor. I know you never felt satisfied by that, which probably eventually led to our downfall.
But I kept you for a few more months until then, didn't I? I deliberately didn't ever tell you anything that indicated sorrow, because I wasn't sorry. You kept asking about it, and I just acted like you were being a nag, never letting it go, even though I know that I never gave you any kind of closure on it. I never gave you any reassurance it would never happen again. I just made my excuse that I only did it because you weren't paying enough attention to me. I didn't want to do it, even though I did it every single week for at least a year that you found out about. Ugh, you bought that. If you bought that and stuck with me, honey, what's the your fault? Because that's the clue I ain't gonna change. I haven't. I've been cheating on my new lover every chance I can get. In fact, I was thinking about calling you the other day. Are you free? Just for, you know, just like old times. But we won't have to tell anyone. I just thought it would be fun. We're here to talk about your friends. If you remember properly, I moved on really quick to some of your friends. I knew when I met you, I had to get in good with all of your friends. Now, a few of them I could recognize from other projects. Those I just avoided. I know how to read people. I could look at her fancy handbag, the brand names on her shoes, and I knew she was a materialistic chick. I know all about that stuff. I engaged in conversations about the latest designer and told her how good she would look in the latest design. It overjoyed her. She was one of my favorites. I got in good with her. I even got her phone number. I became her friend on Facebook, and we would chat about you privately. You started to figure me out. That's when I started on her, saying, I'm really worried about my partner. He's acting kind of strange. I think he might be becoming paranoid. He's accusing me of doing these things I'm not doing. And she took the bait. She agreed. She said she knew there was no way I could ever hurt you, cheat on you. She worked as a go-between. When you tried to dump me because you heard about my excursion in a pool a few nights before, I lied about, I had her on my side. So if I said something about you, I'd say it to her. Why? Because I knew she would be right on the phone calling you or texting you, telling you exactly what I said, and it would help achieve my goals. I didn't have a thing in common with those people. I just needed them for my project. One of them acted strange because I saw her in public and just walked right past her like I didn't know her. My thoughts were, well, honey, your job's over. I don't need you anymore. Do you go back to your old employer? Want to work there when you're done? I don't think so. Well, I was done with her. It's her problem. She shouldn't have trusted me. It's her own fault. Plus, it got me what I wanted. For the moment. At least it got the messages to you that I needed to get to you. People. Wonderful. I used them all. For whatever I want.
With the thrill in my head and the pill on my tongue, these are the nerves that have just begun. Listening to my band all night long, this is the sound of my soul. This is the sound. Oh, it's slipping from my head. There's a time of its soul. Take your feet back, arms and right in the next line. Oh, I want the truth to be known. I know this much is true. I know this much is true. But now I've come back again. Why do I find it hard to write the next line? Oh, I want the truth to say. I know this much is true. I know this much is true.
I've never told you the truth. I'm a liar, and I'm proud of it.